Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to a new episode of the Venom Vlog. Finally, I am settled in Florida, so thank you guys for waiting and being so patient for me. And I have the room set up, as you can see. I'm still tweaking some things. There's a picture that needs to go in that frame. I'm just waiting for it to show up in the mail. It got sent to my old address, and it's being forwarded to my new address, so I'm just waiting on that. But it's coming in from Gray Matter Artwork, so it's another print to match that one there that they sent me before. And I picked up this one. I saw it online, and it looked amazing, so it'll be here soon. So that'll fill in. And then also, I have this like sign up here that lights up that says Venom Vlog, but I noticed that when I hit the light on, you actually can't read the words Venom Vlog. So I'm going to try to find a way to make the letters pop a little bit better, so that way you can see it through the light. So I got to work on some stuff, but I got the track lighting in, I got all the figures and everything set up, and so here we are now with more Venom Vlog stuff. And today we're going to dive back into the comic books, because as you know, there hasn't been a ton of like movie news or anything like that lately, which has been kind of a bummer. But you know, everything going on, I understand people's frustration and impatience. A lot of people have been asking for the trailer. When is the trailer coming out? If you've not seen my other live streams that we've been doing while I was on the road, you'll know that I am not a fan of people losing their minds over wondering where this trailer is. This trailer will come out when it comes out. It's not owed to us at all. I think a lot of people get a little too entitled, and I also feel like maybe people aren't really entitled, but they're just like, they want it so badly because they're like, hey, I'm cooped up inside, I'm bored, I want something to do, I want something to look forward to. And you have to understand that right now with the movie industry going on, it's just hard to put something out, you know, like a trailer out there and say, hey, this movie's definitely coming out on this day, because we really don't know what's going on. I mean, AMC theaters are closed until June. That's going to push a lot of movies that were going to come out already. It's pushing them back, you know, some of them up to a year later. So, you know, we just have to be patient. You know, Sony's working out what they can. They're going to try to figure out when is the best time to release a trailer. So I would just say, don't worry. Just be patient. But it looks like there's a lot of people out there that are just bombarding, like, you know, Trailer Tracker and all these places on Twitter and Instagram, demanding, like, all caps, where's our trailer? Where's our trailer? And it's, you shouldn't act like that. Don't do that. It doesn't represent our fandom properly. It's not how we should act in general. Like, there is a real thing happening in the world. So we have to just acknowledge that. Whether you think it's blown out of proportion or not, I hate when people tell me that. My mom, you know, is on the verge of maybe not having her job. My brother already lost his job. So this is a very real thing, whether you think it's blown out of proportion or not. So don't comment with stuff like that. Don't, you know, that irritates the hell out of me. There are real effects. I've, you know, people dying, people coughing up blood, like going through some really hard stuff and dying alone in hospitals. It's intense. So please, you know, for me, just calm down. We'll get our trailer. Let us figure out where we're going forward in the world, and let, you know, Sony work on what they need to work on. I'm sure they're going to cut together an awesome trailer, and when the time is right, they're going to release it for us. So just be patient. We have Maximum Venom cartoon coming up in like 3 weeks, and I'm sure we're going to get more stuff on that very soon too. So we got Venom content. Don't worry. So with all that out of the way, now that I talked about all that, we just have two single issue comics I want to talk about today, because we've been going through the Flash Thompson Agent Venom stuff. And where we last left off, we were also talking about Agent Anti-Venom and his like Revengers storyline that we did, the two annuals from the Avengers and New Avengers books. So now that that's done, I want to wrap up before we get into Spider Island, which is going to be a big event that has, it's focused on Spider-Man for sure, but it does have big moments for Flash Thompson and Eddie Brock as Anti-Venom, and really big moments, especially for Eddie Brock. So before we get there, I wanted to talk about these two stories because they kind of nestle in right where we left off with Flash and you know, and Eddie, although Eddie's not really part of these two stories, but this is more of a Flash story. These two stories are Flash stories, but it is, there's more of that, you know, like we'll get into Eddie after the Revengers. He's just kind of out there in the wild, so we don't really know where he is now, but we'll see him show up in the Spider Island event. So that'll probably be the next comic book episode that we talk about. But then in this one, you know, these are two one-shots that focus on Flash and kind of his relationship with Betty, Peter Parker, and his own father, too. So this was an issue I was supposed to get to in a previous video. I was going to, you know, talk about Venom number 1 through 5 by Rick Remender, but we didn't get to issue 5. I mentioned it briefly, but I forgot to talk about it in depth. And so I figured let's focus a whole episode on it, along with a short story called Crossroads, which we'll talk about first, which is an Amazing Spider-Man 665, written by Dan Slott and art by Ryan Stegman, the current Venom artist, current as, you know, of us recording this video. Although Mark Bagley's doing Venom Island right now, but still, Ryan Segman's the kind of the go-to artist on that book. So this is Spider-Man, Amazing Spider-Man 665. Dan Slott tells a really, really great and tragic, but heartwarming, and kind of true to form Peter Parker story. It's really moving stuff. It kind of focuses on Betty Brant and Peter Parker. Betty Brant is Peter Parker's one of his first crushes in the comic book. She was older than him. She worked at the Daily Bugle. She was like an assistant to J. Jonah Jameson, and Peter just had a crush on her. He had a schoolboy crush on her, and she kind of always, sometimes as he got older, especially, she would flirt back, and there was a chemistry there, but not one for a relationship, not a like full on relationship. They realize that eventually they were just better friends, and that's kind of what Dan Slott kind of talks about in this issue, is how Peter was like, yeah, she was a crush, I had a crush on her, but now she's like my best friend, and she's like the older sister I always wanted. And so he talks about, Peter's like, we have this thing, every once a month we go out on a Friday night, we see a movie, and we just, that's kind of our movie night. It's our girls' night, as he calls it. And it's like, and I get that Peter's, using that ironically, but he's also. He is. He became best friends with Betty, and this is the thing they bonded on. He's like, all right, so this is our ritual, basically. Not a lot of friends have rituals. And he's like, yeah, this is our ritual. We go to a movie once a month on a Friday. But, sometimes things get in the way. I have to fight the Shocker. I have to fight, other villains. But there have been times where I've actually kept, our commitment. Up until recently, now that Peter Parker, during this point in the comics, he's working for Horizon Labs, and he's inventing stuff, and he's actually using the science part of his brain. And he's not just a freelance photographer, down on his luck guy. He's actually making money and doing pretty well. He's also on two Avengers teams, and he's a member of the Fantastic Four. So Peter's got a lot going on in his life, and so he's very busy. And he's telling Betty, "Hey, I can't meet you for this movie." And she's like, "Well, it's called Crossroads de l'Amour. I'd really like," and that's the name of this story, which I thought was cool. It's called Crossroads, and she's like, "It's called Crossroads de l'Amour, and I'd really like to have you there with me. It'd be great to watch this movie with you." And he said, "Yeah, I understand. That's great, but I just can't make it." And she's like, "Peter, like, I kind of," and she's joking, but she kind of, maybe is a little serious, where she's like, "I miss the Peter that used to, at least make this, make the effort every once in a while, like when you were down on your luck." And he's like, "Wait. Now that I'm successful, which is something you've always wanted me to be, is pursue my science mind. Now that I'm doing it and I can't make time for you, now you're giving me crap about it." And he's like, "Yeah, okay, have a good night." And they kind of end on a little bit of a sour note, which friends do sometimes, right? So she goes off to this movie, and after the movie, she gets mugged and beaten and robbed, and it is very real, because, like, these moments obviously do happen in the real world, but this is the kind of stuff that Spider-Man stories, are really great at, is having these really real moments where, as Peter, has to make a decision. What do I do? Do I do the Spider-Man thing, or do I do the friendship thing? So, of course, in this one, Peter decides to do the Spider-Man thing. He finds out she gets mugged. She gets rushed to hospital. Her roommate, Glory Grant, is there. I think it's Glory Grant, and Glory is her roommate, and she's like, "Hey, I'm her emergency contact. What happened to her?" And the doctor's like, "Look, things aren't looking too well. She has a massive head trauma. She's got a cracked rib, some internal bleeding. Like, we gotta, do an operation on her. But we're trying to be hopeful, but we don't know how this is gonna work out." Meanwhile, of course, Flash, he couldn't be there because he's off on a Venom mission, but he did get the call, like, saying that she was in the hospital. So he's, wrapping up his Venom mission and coming back, to be with her. And then also J. Jonah Jameson, who looks at her as, he's like, "Hey, Betty Brant's like a daughter to me. She was my assistant for many years. So I want to be here. I want to transfer to a better hospital." And they're like, "No, we got to operate now. If we move her, it could be too late." So, everyone's kind of going through their grief with this, and they're preparing for the fact that Betty could actually die. And you see all these family members in the room, and people are waiting. They're wondering where Peter Parker is. Of course, Mary Jane is like coming up with excuses for him, and Aunt May's like, "No more excuses, Mary Jane. And again, no one in this room really knows he's Spider-Man, except I think maybe Mary Jane does." But he's like, Aunt May's like, "We need to get Peter here immediately." So, meanwhile, Peter, as Spider-Man, is running around town finding out who this guy is. He goes to a pawn shop. He finds this guy who's, basically been taking in stuff. And Peter's like, "Look, I've known about you for a while, but you're a middleman. You're scum, and I've just let you go because, as far as I know, you've never had any blood on your hands. But now someone was beaten, and the person who beat her probably brought his merchandise here because it happened just on the block to sell it to you. And then he looks up and Peter sees a pendant that belongs to Betty Brandt. And this pendant was given to Betty by her mother before she passed away. And it's something that she mentioned on her first movie night with Peter. Peter's like, oh, that's a nice pendant. She's like, yeah, my mom gave it to me before she died. So Peter remembered that. And he said, all right, who's the guy that sold you this pendant? This belongs to the victim that was beaten. And Spider-Man goes on a rampage. And as he's doing it, he's remembering Uncle Ben. He's remembering the time that he stood by and did nothing when a criminal got away. And so he tracks this guy down. He's beaten the crap out of all these lowlives. And these lowlives guys are like, hey, look, I have intel on, you know, the owl and scorpion. You know, do you want any of that? And Spider-Man's like, no, I just want this, you know, this nothing street guy who his name's like Finch something. And he's like, I just want him. Like, give me him now. And then Spider-Man put a tracer on one of the guys and followed him, and it led him to the person he was after, the person who mugged Betty Brandt. And so this issue had a lot of emotion in it. And Peter's sitting there and he's like, okay, I'm ready to go. And the guy, you know, the criminal who finds Finch, he's like, hey, you need to get out of town right now. So Peter's like, I got to make a move. Otherwise, I could lose this guy forever. And then just as he's about to, he gets a phone call and he's like, Aunt May, what is it? And she's like, you need to be here right now for your friend. She's just got out of, surgery, and we're not sure, how long, if she'll survive. You need to be here right now. And Peter's like, no. He's like, I'm doing something very important. And she goes, do you remember the night your Uncle Ben died? And he's like, of course. It's been on my mind all night ever since I heard about Betty. And it has, you know, he's remembering his responsibility angles of like what happened that night. What I love that Dan Slott did here is he puts a different perspective on that evening through the eyes of Aunt May. Aunt May said, you went out after Uncle Ben died and we found out who the shooter was, or if we found out there was a shooter. You went into your room and then me and the police went into your room to talk to you and you were gone. And she's like, what was so important that you, a teenage boy, had to leave in the middle of the night your uncle died, and you couldn't stay and be with me during my most vulnerable time? Why did you choose something else other than being with me? And that is honestly something I never, ever thought about or considered. So when I was, you know, reading this, I started to tear up. I was like, wow, yeah, she's right. That is pretty selfish of Peter to go do that. And then what ended up happening is he found that it was the guy he let go earlier. So just really moving stuff. And then so Peter says, you know what? You're right. And so he hangs up the phone. And he watches as the criminal gets away. But Peter does show up at the hospital and he's on watch. You know, Betty's asleep and she wakes up. It's like a day later and she wakes up and Peter's there. And she's like, oh, Peter, how long have you been here? And he goes, well, actually, it's just my shift. We've been coming in here in like one at a time in like 2-3 hour increments. And he goes, so you just happen to wake up during my shift. You know, that's the Parker luck. And she's like, and he's like, look, I'm sorry I didn't go to the movie with you. Because that was the thing that was building up to this was she kept asking Peter and Flash, like, will you go? Like, she asked Flash later, but she kept asking Peter, please go to this movie with me. Like, you know, it's something that it's been showing for 3 weeks or 4 weeks now. It's limited release. And then each week, you know, she keeps getting rejected at the beginning of the story from Peter because he has a different, you know, Horizon Lab thing where he has to go fight with the Fantastic Four or the Avengers. And so that's when it bottles into that moment where they have an argument. But really, she's been trying to get him to go see this movie and throughout the whole like first 6-7 pages of this book. And he kept saying, no, I can't do it. I can't do it. And so now he's like, I feel bad. He's like, you went to a bad part of town on a night where you asked me to drop everything I was doing to come to see this movie with you. And I called it a stupid movie. And I'm so sorry. And he's like, I should have thought about what this meant to you and not what I was working on. He goes, now, granted, I am working on big scientific things that could make breakthroughs. He goes, but I should always find time to be there for someone who needs me and for a friend. And he goes, and I've blown you off so much. I feel directly responsible. I should have been there with you tonight and you probably wouldn't have been mugged. And she's like, you don't know that, Peter. You know, you could have gotten hurt too or shot or whatever. And of course, Peter's like, yeah, that wouldn't have happened. I'm Spider-Man. But she doesn't know that. So he's like, yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I wasn't there. So he feels directly responsible, of course, in that Peter Parker way. And of course, Aunt May's like, you got to let it go. And he's like, yeah, I'm not going to be able to let this go. Like, this is just like similar to Uncle Ben. I should have been there. And I should have done the right thing and been with a friend. This story was amazing and touching. And it was so great to see her wake up from that, from her surgery and that she was fine. And then when she wakes up, Peter's like, look, I know it's not the movie you wanted. But I did rent like a 50s monster movie. And he's like, maybe we can sit and watch this tonight. And so she's like, oh man, she's like, I really don't want to. And he's like, come on, it's movie night. And he's like, and I owe you one. She goes, yeah, but you owed me a good movie, not this. And he's like, all right, well, I'll let you pick the movie next time. He's like, this is just the DVD I had on me. So they sit in the hospital bed together and watch it. And he has like popcorn or whatever. And then outside, Flash is there, and he shows up, and he's like, they're like, what's going on? He peeks in the room and he goes, look, it's their movie night. He's like, it's a thing they do. And he's like, and I'm glad that they're friends after all this time. And I'm glad Peter came through for her tonight, and to be here with her. And he goes, so why don't we just all go home? It looks like she's awake and she looks fine. So, and the doctor was like, yeah, her vitals are fine. She's going to be okay. So everyone's like, all right, good. Like, you guys go, Flash is like, I'll stay here and I'll watch the next shift after their movie's over. And then, Glory, you can, come after me. So they kind of say their goodbyes at that point. So yeah, it ends with like Betty saying something like, please tell me this crappy 50s movie doesn't end with a the end ... question mark. And then of course, that's how the comic ends, which is as the end, question mark. And I thought that was pretty funny too. So yeah, Dan Slott did a really good job of this issue, and Ryan Stegman drew the hell out of it, and it was so fantastic. And I highly recommend you picking it up. It's Amazing Spider-Man 665. It's part of the Infested storyline. It's in the Return of Anti-Venom graphic novel, so you can get it on Comixology, either single issue or the graphic novel. It's awesome. All right, and last up, we're going to talk about Venom number 5 by Rick Remender and art by Tony Moore, actually. Yeah, Tony Moore, who drew Walking Dead in the first couple issues. So he comes back on issue 5 here. And this is a standalone story, and this is taking place, I guess, after the Infested storyline. So Betty is, been released from the hospital. She's back home. She's kind of being told to stay indoors for now, so she can recover. And meanwhile, Flash is out there as Venom. He takes down the human fly at the beginning, which is pretty cool. And they fight in a church where the church bell, like Venom, gets pushed up against a church bell and it rings and it weakens him. But Human Fly is too dumb to figure out that that was a weakness, so he spits acid up and drops the bell on Flash. But Flash is able to pick it up and throw it back at him and take him down. So that was pretty good. And he saves like the governor's daughter or someone like that, or the mayor's daughter. So yeah, Flash, putting a name for himself, make himself a hero out there as Agent Venom. So it's pretty cool. But that only happens in the first like couple pages. The rest of the book is when Flash is on his off time. Now he's home. He's with Betty. He's in his wheelchair and he's going, doing his meetings, doing all that stuff. And then he gets home, from a long night of work as Venom, and also going, to the VA and stuff like that. Or that's like the cover story. But he still kind of, gets involved with the government. He's talking to them, so he calls that going to the VA. But after a long night of, hunting down the human fly, he comes home and he gets a message from his mom. And his mom says, this is Eugene. This is about your dad. He's been drinking again lately, and now he's missing. I can't find him. He's been gone for like a whole day. Can you please help me find him? And he gets pissed, picks up the answer machine and throws it, and then wheels out of his apartment. And goes right to Betty's house. And when he gets there, she's like, hey, you're actually here on time for our date. And he's like, yeah, with everything that's been going on, the hospital trips and everything, he's like, I just wanted to be here for you tonight. And he goes, so I told the VA I'm not available, and and I have some other things going on with my mom, but I'm gonna push it off for now, and I want to spend time with you. And she's like, hey, thanks. So she's cooking and they're talking, and then he gets a phone call again from his mom, and he's on his cell phone, and he's like, what, mom? And she's like, please help me find your father. And he says, no. He starts screaming at his mom, no, I told you, if he starts drinking again, we're done. He's like, yeah, a couple years ago, you came to me and you said, after I joined the army, that dad started to sober up because he was actually proud of me. And that they show like Flash, Flash kind of looks back at his life and he says, I've always been this 10-year-old boy trying to get the, acceptance of my father. And I'm like, that's so crazy. That's Eddie Brock has been trying to do that with his own father too. What a great parallel there that I never realized before. And then so in this issue, he's like, I try to get dad's affection, but he just beat me. He drank, he beat you. And after I was old enough, I left, and I left home, and I wanted nothing to do with them. And he goes, but when I joined the army, I did see a shred of pride in his eyes, and that led him to being sober. And he got like a 2-year chip, fighting, with his sobriety and stuff. And he was, actually accomplishing goals and trying to change. And he wanted to rebond with his son after all these years. So he goes and talks to Flash and says, hey, I'm sober, and please give me a second chance. I'm sorry everything that's been going on. But once Flash lost his legs in the war, I guess his dad reverted back to drinking, but it was coincidence. Flash thinks it may be because of him, but it turns out it's going to be for another reason. So when Flash gets the phone call from his mom, he's like, look, I'm sorry I yelled at you. where was the last time you saw dad, or where'd you hear he was going to go to drink? And she's like, oh, I heard he might go to this bar. And they're like, okay, I'm going to go look for him. And so Betty's like, do you want me to come with you? And he's like, no. He's like, you need to stay. You need to rest. He's like, I'm going to go do this, on my own. And when he leaves, he actually doesn't do it on his own. He calls Peter Parker and he says, Peter, can you please come with me for something very important? I'll explain on the way. So Peter shows up, and when he finds out, he's like, I'm so glad I came. I'm sorry. I'm trying to be there more for friends, especially after what happened to Betty. So, what do you need from me? And he's like, I just need you to be with me to make sure I don't punch and beat the crap out of my dad. And he goes, but you're not like your dad, Flash. He's like, you're a good person and you're a hero. And he goes, and I look up to you. And Flash is like, yeah, but I've been through a lot. My dad has put me through a lot. He drank, he beat me. There was a point in my life where I drank, and I got aggressive and I pushed Betty away from me. And he goes, and I became my father. And he goes, and if it wasn't for the military, I probably would have continued to be like my father. And he goes, but I still feel that rage inside of me, that boy that hates his father. I still feel it. And he's like, so I just need to make sure a friend is nearby to make sure I don't do anything stupid. So Peter's like, I believe in you, Flash. He's like, so I'll be there with you. He goes, but I know I'm not going to have to restrain you because I know you're a good person. And I love seeing this because Flash is such a good guy, but he doesn't see himself as a good guy. And that's always like great for character stuff. And so him and Peter go to a couple different bars and they don't find his dad. And then finally they get a call from the police department, NYPD, and where his dad used to work, and his former partner, Paul, calls Eddie, or not Eddie, sorry, calls Flash, and he says, hey, Flash, your dad's here at the precinct. Can you come down? So Flash and Peter go down there, and he sees him, and then his dad turns around. He says, screw you, what are you doing here? You're a cripple now. You're just sucking off the government's teat, taking free money. You're a freeloader. He's like, and he goes, Dad, I got wounded saving people's lives. And he goes, so screw you. You don't get to talk to me like that. And he goes, and screw you for drinking again and putting mom through, bringing all those memories of how bad our lives were. We were actually getting past all this. Why are you being so selfish right now? Why are you doing this to us? You're destroying her. He's like, I don't care about me because I don't love you anymore. The second that alcohol hits your lips again, you were dead to me. But mom still loves you for some stupid reason. He's like, so, maybe because she sees that you could be a good person. So why don't you do that? Why don't you like put the bottle down and actually be a good person for her? And his dad is like, screw you, and he goes to swing at Flash, but Flash pulls back on his wheelchair, dodges it, and then grabs his dad and pulls him down to his knee and gets ready to hit him. He's like, just do it. He's like, punch him right in the face, break his nose, shut his mouth up, break his jaw. He's like, just knock him out. He deserves it. He deserves to be hit for all the times he hit you, for all the times he hit your mom. Hit him back. And Flash can't do it. He looks up at Peter and he says, sorry, this brought up some memories actually reading this book. For those of you who don't know, obviously, I've went through a similar situation with my dad. So when he grabs his dad, he's like, I want to punch him so bad, and he doesn't do it. Peter says, I knew you wouldn't do it, dude. I knew you wouldn't do it. You're a good guy, Flash. I believed in you, and I knew when the moment came, you were not going to hit your dad back. And so Flash does it. So then they Flash's dad falls to the ground. Something's wrong with him. They bring him into the hospital. And that's when the truth gets revealed to Flash that his dad has some kind of liver problem, like a cancer, and it's killing him. And he found out about a year ago, and he just was too proud to tell anybody. And instead of dealing with it and telling people and looking for comfort and friendship and whatever anything else he could have found to make his last days better, looks like he just decided to drink again, which just exasperated his condition, made his liver worse, and now he's basically on his deathbed at the end. And Flash's mom's in there and she's crying. She's holding, her husband's hand. And Flash is outside the room with Peter. And Peter's like, do you want to go in and say anything? And Flash is like, Peter, thanks for being here with me. He goes, I'll be right back. And he goes in and he sees his dad one last time. And his dad looks over and he says, Eugene, and he reaches his hand out and he's like, please take my hand, son. And, Flash's mom looks at him like, are you going to do it? Are you going to, take his hand and forgive him? This could be the last time you see him. And Flash looks at his dad and wheels back and leaves the room and leaves the hospital, and does not say goodbye to his dad, does not give him his hand, does not forgive him, and lets his dad die with the selfish decision he made. And he says, he says, it sucks that my dad couldn't continue on the path he was on of being a better man, because that could have led to him having a last year that was worthwhile, where we all got to go out, where he got to die at peace, and we all got to be at peace with each other, and have overcome, all of our hardships, and show that we've actually all grown in some way. And he goes, but of course, my dad had to pull the selfish move at the end, drink himself to near death, and then try to and then ruin our lives, ruin my mother's, version or vision of him, showing her that, her having faith in him all these years, that he might be a better person, threw that down the toilet, ruined my relationship with him. I gave him a second chance, but I told him if he drank again, it was over. My dad, would rather have done that and ended his life on a bad note, where our lives are now a mess because of it. He'd rather that than do the selfless thing and the part of him that actually grew and die in peace, and die a better man. And he goes, and I hate him for that. And he's like, so I'm not going to spend my last moments or his last moments with him. I'm not going to do it. And then he wheels off and he leaves, and it's a man, like, this story was really heartbreaking. And, kudos to Rick Remender for doing something like this in the storyline. I mean, I know there's a lot of people out there who did grow up in abusive scenarios when they were kids, and maybe as adults they never got some form of closure or anything like that. So it was interesting to read that in a Flash Thompson story, because it was all set up. I mean, we've learned in the past that, he's had that kind of, upbringing. And that's what I love about Rick Remender, is he takes what's there and he expands on it. And he's like, you know what? Let's not, I'm not here to retcon stuff. I feel like any other writer who doesn't know what they're doing would come in and say, you know what? Eddie wasn't abused, or Eddie, Flash wasn't abused as a kid. It was this, and they changed it, and they changed it to fit their story. Remender didn't do that. He was like, no, let's look at what's there. What's there is very real. Let's discuss it, and let's make a whole, issue on it. And so this issue was freaking amazing, and it brought me to tears, because, like I said, it was very real. I grew up in a similar situation. I had a similar moment that Flash did to bring closure. And Flash is a good guy. That's all I can say, man. He's a fictional character, obviously, but that's a good example he set in this issue. And that was a great story by Remender, and Tony Moore's artwork was awesome. So, yeah, these two issues, I want to talk a lot about them, because they're very real. These are the kind of stories I think are perfect for Venom stories, because they've kind of similar to Spider-Man stories, but there's always a darker edge to the Venom ones. And that's why I don't like, the big events, like everyone gets a symbiote and all that. It's like, yeah, it's fun for every once in a while for like a cartoon or for like a comic, but they've done it so many times in the comics now, and we're gonna get Maximum Venom, which I'm excited for. But it's like, I don't know what new twist they're gonna put on it. Anytime there's a new twist, I'm down for that. I'm down to at least read it one more time. But I feel like most people, when they come on the character of Venom, they're like, oh, let's build to a big event where other people get symbiotes and everything like that. And it looked like even Rick Remender had that plan, and we'll talk about that in an upcoming episode. But it looks like Rick Remender had a plan to do a story called War of the Symbiotes, which is funny because there was an Ultimate story called War of the Symbiotes also. But he never got to do it, and I'm kind of glad on one level, because it's just like, that we do get that story a lot, and these are the type of stories I like. That's why I liked Mike Costa's run. It didn't go like that route. I mean, the only co it got big towards the end, but it was only to introduce Sleeper, which was a cool addition to the mythos of Venom, and also tied it to the Kree-Skrull War and how the symbiote ended up on Battleworld. So I like that. That was cool, but that wasn't like this big build-up, big crossover event. That was just like a nice self-contained thing. It was street-level stories up until then. And that's where I think Venom is strongest. So these two issues were amazing. I love them. I can't recommend them enough. So pick up Amazing Spider-Man 665, or the Return of Anti-Venom trade, and pick up the Rick Remender trade. I think it has the first five issues of Agent Venom in here. So you'll get this issue, or you can pick up this issue on your own. It's awesome. Like I said, it's very emotional. Sorry I got so caught up in it. But when I was rereading this, I reread it today, this morning, and I cried then, and then I was like, ah, in the video I'll be able to keep it together, and no way, man. It's too close to home for me. And it was, man, it was great to read. So I can't recommend it enough. So you guys, let me know what you think. Have you read these two issues? If so, let me know down below. And also, I talked about the Venom trailer in the beginning. Yeah, cool off on that. We'll get it when we get it. Don't worry. Just be patient. And thank you all very much for supporting the show. And now that it's back, we have more episodes coming up very soon. Thanks so much. See you in the future. Peace.